The first multi-million dollar CRISPR drug is finally to market, so that's making everybody wonder if Intellia is going to be the second company after CRISPR Therapeutics to bring a gene editing drug to market. So we're going to talk about that. We're going to see what's up with base and prime editing. As a bonus, we're going to look at a recent gene editing IPO. And if you're an Editas or a Caribou investor, your ears are going to perk up during this presentation because those royalties you've been hoping for may finally be here. So the ideal gene editing business model would look something like this. So it takes an Intel inside approach. That means you license your technology with royalty upside. So initial milestone payments, and then down the road, you get a cut of the success. You would then spend that money heavily on R&D or M&A activity to improve your technology. What you'd end up with is a high margin business with a broad and deep pipeline. So the idea is to have not just one winner, but a winner every year. Consistent progression and sufficient partners will start to smooth your revenue as the company scales. So in order to find such a company, we took a look at 27 gene editing stocks in this article, aptly titled A Complete List of 27 Gene Editing Stocks, and that pulled from this Kelly CRISPR and Gene Editing Technology Index, which was used to produce an ETF called XDNA. Now that it only has about $2.5 million in AUM, so it's barely surviving, but the list of names is certainly something that we can look to when trying to find leaders in this space. So you can see here that 80% of the ETF is made up of these names at the top, the usual suspects there, CRISPR and Beam. In third place, Thermo Fisher. Now, we did a piece on them recently, and that's not a gene editing company. They provide life sciences tools. There's a very loose connection there. Then you have Intellia, Prime, Editas, Caribou. We get to Verve and Poseida. Now, I scratched off AbbVie as well because they're certainly not a gene editing company. But when it comes to Verve, they're doing some interesting stuff trying to make cholesterol pills obsolete. So the Americans, I don't know about people abroad, take lots of these things. So you see here this piece from a Biopharma Dive earlier this year. It says, Verve pauses base editing trial, shifts strategy after treatment side effect. That's certainly something you never want to be reading about your company. So when it comes to Poseida Therapeutics, we had come across them in a previous piece we did 6 years ago looking at the top funded synthetic biology companies, and they happen to be on that list. You'll see some other familiar names here as well. Look at the top there, Moderna and Zymergen. They went bankrupt. We had some concerns around them, etc. So Poseida is a cancer immunotherapy startup, and we've really tried to gravitate away from these very technically complex value propositions when it comes to cancer treatments. Now, when we look at the top six editing stocks by market cap, you'll see there at the top CRISPR, Intellia, and Beam, and then Prime, Editas, and Caribou. They're all much smaller. Now, we just did this piece checking in with seven gene editing stocks. You ought to give that a read because we cover those three names in thorough detail, and there's a lot of great, interesting information in this article. In fact, you can search our website and click on the gene editing tag, and we've got dozens of articles on gene editing. We've done quite a bit of research. For those of you that are premium subscribers, you can pull up our tech stock catalog, filter on the subcategory gene editing, and you'll get 13 names that you see here, along with some notes and links to the latest research. Now, let's talk about the big winner here, CASGEVY. This is from CRISPR. You see here the typical friendly advertisement of a granddaughter and grandmother doing yoga. U.S. is one of two countries in the world where drug manufacturers are allowed to directly market to citizens. So I've circled here 12 years and older. That's relevant for a reason we're going to come to later. Now, this drug has been approved, and CRISPR and Vertex are working together to sell this now. So they said they've collected cells from five patients. The process sounds grueling. So these individuals need to undergo intense chemotherapy before receiving edited cells from the cells that have been collected from them. Now, five patients would equal $11 million. The profit split here is going to be 60-40 favoring Vertex. So until we have some financial information, and we're told that by analysts that Both these firms should expect around $85 million this year from CASGEVY, so we'll get to see what margins look like. Now, what about the other 30,000 patients out there that represent a $64 billion TAM? Well, they're going to be slowly progressing through the total addressable market. We'll talk about that in a second, but one of our premium subscribers raised an excellent question. What happens if everyone gets cured? So this is a cure, not just a treatment, right? So I pulled up this data from the CDC, and on the left there, you'll see an interesting finding. A pandemic baby bump is happening in the U.S., they say. Working from home may have boosted fertility among college-educated women. Well, that's one way to put it, right? So according to the CDC, about 3.6 million babies were born in the United States in 2023. So that's a 2% decrease from 2022, and it's the lowest number of births since 1979. I thought that was interesting. And it resumes this 2% annual decline that's been seen since before the pandemic. Now, prevalence for sickle cell disease, that's what CASGEVY addresses. Prevalence for that is one in every 2,070 babies. So if we run the math, that means 1,735 new patients per year. So if half are treated, that's about a $1.74 billion run rate. That's not bad. So what then you can do is to start modeling revenues. And I just put this together as an example. So Bloomberg says that by 2030, both Vertex and CRISPR will see $2.2 billion from CASGEVY, and that run rate may sustain itself for a while before it starts decreasing because you're penetrating the total addressable market. And then you're going to reach a stabilization level where people who are turning 12, or let's say young adults, are then getting this treatment to cure their sickle cell disease. So just running these simple numbers, by 2030, using this 60% growth, that means they'll have treated 2,272 patients, or about 7% market penetration of the 32,000. At a peak of $2.2 billion in revenue, that would be about 1,000 patients a year. So what we need to do next, then, is just look at margins. Now, one interesting thing about the total addressable market, I came across this piece, Vertex to develop conditioning agent for sickle cell disease gene editing therapy. So what's going to happen is that these green shoots of revenue are going to start creating a lot of volatility around the stock as analysts adjust their models. And Vertex is going to provide a lot of information too. So pay attention to them if you're a CRISPR investor. Now, what Vertex is doing is they're paying this other firm, Immunogen, money to use this ADC technology to develop, quote unquote, gentler and more targeted conditioning agents. The idea, remember I said that patients need to undergo intense chemotherapy. It's quite aggressive. So the idea there is that they'll be able to solve for that. And if they do, then look at how much the addressable market, they say, will expand from 30,000 patients to five times that number. So what, you're in over a $100 billion opportunity there, according to Vertex. Now, one thing that we noticed around Vertex, again, paying attention to what Vertex is doing to see progress here, is that another company that's going to benefit from CASGEVY is Editas. So there's been a lot of speculation around intellectual property and who's going to get what. And you see here that Vertex and Editas entered into an agreement which extends the Editas cash runway, they say, into 2026. It's a non-exclusive license agreement. So presumably then, they had to do this, and Editas, this was late last year, is going to get some upside. Now, when we look at Editas, we sold them several years ago. This $387 million company exited last quarter with $377 million in cash. So that's suspect when a firm is valued around their cash. It shows you the market doesn't have a value for the rest of their business. As I said, when combined with these expected revenues, it's extended their runway. Now, when we look at what Editas is doing, I don't understand this. Why are they developing a treatment just like the one we described coming from CRISPR that's already been approved to target sickle cell disease and TDT? So those are the two diseases that are being targeted by CRISPR. So this is a similar ex vivo treatment. When CASGEVY is going into commercialization and Beam is working on in vivo, so just some clarification of the terms, really simple. In vivo is inside the body. You give somebody a shot and it solves the problem. That's highly desirable. Ex vivo means you need to take their cells out, you need to edit them, give them chemotherapy, so much more complicated and expensive. So Beam's working on in vivo, one shot and quit therapy. So they claim that obviously is superior for obvious reasons, right? So I don't understand what Editas is doing here. But let's move on then and look at what Intellia is doing. So that's the company that claims they'll have the first in vivo gene editing treatment. They're working with Regeneron on this ATTR disease. You can see here late stage clinical progress. And this slide describes that opportunity. I thought this was interesting that you have 50,000 patients worldwide with this ATTR condition, and their life expectancy is 2 to 7 years once diagnosed. So that's a big problem, right? And then you see you also have an additional 200 to 500,000 patients worldwide who have a 10 plus year life expectancy after diagnosis. But what happens is that this disease creates some highly burdensome symptoms. And in order to reduce this problem, it's $450,000 a year. So why not just pay $2 million and cure it for good, and then the person is cured. So it seems very appealing. When we look at Intellia's deck, they do a good job of telling us about key clinical program milestones. You see here they say, initiate a pivotal phase 3 study for ATTR by year end. So the word pivotal is key here. So a successful pivotal trial, it's usually a phase 3, is required as evidence for drug marketing approval by the approval authorities. So that means they should be getting close. Now, another winner, if Intellia actually is able to market this drug, would be Caribou. So when you read the details in Intellia's documentation there, it says that they're eligible to earn from Regeneron, right, their partner, high single digits to low teens. And from that, they need to pay low to mid single digit royalty obligations under a license with Caribou. So it looked something like this. Intellia gets 7 to 12% and Caribou gets of that 1 to 5%. So we really want to see what that looks like. Without revenues, we won't be able to. Now, when it comes to Caribou, again, you have a problem here. They only have $329 million in cash on their balance sheet. And well, three years of runway isn't half bad. They burnt through about $90 million during each of the past 2 years. But their current market cap of $145 million means that the market thinks that cash, so it's valued at half of its cash, isn't going to be sufficient to fund company operations. They're going to need to raise more capital. That's what the market seems to think, at extremely depressed share prices, or take on more debt, or they just collect those royalties. So it's very important for Caribou that we see a success from Intellia and it starts to put some cash in their coffers. Now, let's move to talking about Beam and Beam editing. So their 2023 highlights, they point to that CRISPR-based product approval for sickle cell disease. And a couple interesting things. Lilly acquired Beam's rights to the Verve programs. Rather interesting, right? And Beam has extended their cash runway into 2027, so 3 more years. And they say here, prioritize portfolio to focus on core value drivers in sickle cell disease and AATD. So look at their pipeline. Remember I said Beam is working on a sickle cell disease treatment that's going to be one shot and done, and that's what they're doing. They think that will be superior. And then the other candidate here for AATD, you see that's a liver genetic disease, and they're also working on that as well. Now, another company that was working with Beam on their sickle cell disease drug was Prime Medicine. We covered them several years ago. Well, look at Prime's pipeline now. That sickle cell disease treatment is nowhere to be seen. So I don't know what happened with that partnership, but it's gone. And they're now focused on this chronic granulomatous disease, right? And these medical terms can be rough. It's CGD, if you will. What's interesting about Prime is that they have an investment from Google. So Google owns about 12% of this company. And as a result, perhaps, or maybe it has to be somewhat related, they trade at a premium of twice their cash versus a par or discount to their cash. So I think that Google recently increased their investment in Prime Medicine, which Google is an extremely large firm, so don't read too much into that, but it's interesting nonetheless. One of the things gene editing investors need to consider is that CRISPR or prime editing or base editing, these things may not be final technology that quote unquote wins. So you see here, they're still developing new gene editing systems. Here's one called Mobi, gives researchers a new tool. I thought this was interesting. Humans are all 99.6% identical. That small 0.4% accounts for any difference between one person and another. And what they're looking to address are mutations where You have a condition called multiplexing, where you're essentially installing multiple point mutations simultaneously. So like multiple edits simultaneously. Well, when you look at what I think it was Primer Beam said, 90% of known diseases can be addressed with just a very simple find and replace gene editing technology. So it remains to be seen which technology ultimately works. We have one now, CRISPR, that is seeing commercialization, so that's very promising. Now, ideally, when we think about gene editing, it would be nice to have some AI algorithms go out there and help us improve the technology. And here's an ideal business model for what that might look like. So you could use AI to identify every possible gene editing tool found in nature. You could select a subset of the most ideal candidates and start down the path to commercialization to prove this concept. You could then create intellectual property around those different variants and start to get high margin royalties and then spend your time launching lawsuits against people who aren't paying you. Well, that's precisely what this next firm is doing, Metagenomi. So we covered them. This video is certainly worth a watch. I'll leave that with you next. Please make sure to subscribe to this channel, support our work. Thanks so much for taking the time to watch this today.